Recently, my friend went to a bank and she noted that the home loan rates were not reflecting the RBI's repo rate cut changes. Also, she noted that the earlier home loans were also not reflecting the repo rate changes. So she wondered, why was this happening? When the RBI is reducing its repo rate, then why isn't it reflecting in the home loan rates? Hi guys, I'm Srishti and I welcome you all to our channel Anuj Jindal. Today we'll be discussing about the interest rate evolution from the start, starting from the BPLR to base rate to MCLR and now the external benchmarking system. For your convenience, I have divided the video into four parts. The first part talks about the BPLR and its shortcomings. The second part talks about the base rate and its superiority over the BPLR system and also its shortcomings. The third part talks about the MCLR and how is it superior to the base rate system. And also we will discuss about the case of my friend that why isn't the MCLR was reflecting the RBI's repo rate changes. And the fourth part is the external benchmarking system. So get your notebooks and jot down the important points, as at the end of the video I will be asking you two questions to evaluate yourself. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel, hit the bell icon. So starting with the today's topic, we all know the purpose of any central bank for reducing the repo rates. So why does any central bank try to reduce the repo rate, which means they try to reduce the interest rates in the economy? So all the central banks wants to ensure a direct correlation between the RBI's repo rate changes and the bank interest rates. So if a central bank is reducing its repo rate to a level, then it is expecting the banks to decrease their interest rates so as to boost the economy, for which purpose the RBI is reducing its repo rate. So this is the whole idea behind the RBI's repo rate cuts. And because of this concept, there has been interest rate evolutions from the start. So, to have an overview of the interest rate systems that have been there in the past, I shall be drawing a timeline for you guys. In 2003, BPLR system was introduced. In 2010, base rate system was there. In 2016, MCLR was in place. And now, it is the external benchmark system. So one by one we'll be discussing everything in detail and in brief so that you could understand, and this is a really important topic and you could expect a question from this in your examinations. So starting with the BPLR system. So BPLR, it stands for the benchmark prime lending rate, and it was introduced in April 2003. So by definition, it means that it is a basic and a minimum interest rate which can be offered to the most creditworthy customers of the bank. So this system was not perfect and we will be discussing why was this so. The first point is that there was no fixed formula prescribed by the RBI. So any bank could charge any rate from different customers. So the tagline different rate for different customers will be suitable for this type of interest rate system. So as there was no fixed formula, what banks did was banks charged sub BPLR rates to its most privileged customers. And what sub BPLR rates means? So this is a very important term, sub BPLR rates. Sub BPLR means going in the negative side of the BPLR. For suppose, if a bank is charging 8% to its customers, so sub BPLR rate would mean it is charging say 4% or 5% to its most privileged customers. The privileged customers are those customers having great and a good relationship with the banks. So from the sub BPLR system, there comes a concept which is cross-subsidization. By definition, cross-subsidization means charging higher prices to one type of customers so that to artificially lower the prices, in our case rates, to different type of the customers. So with example, I will be explaining you this. Suppose there are two customers of the bank. The first customer A belongs to the group of most creditworthy customers of the bank, and second customer B is not belonging to that group. So what bank did was, banks charge say 4% to the customer A and charged say 8% to customer B, when its BPLR was say 5%. So it means that bank is charging higher interest rates to customer B so that it could artificially lower the interest rate which it is charging to customer A. So this is known as cross subsidization. Now, as I've discussed with you that what was the RBI's objective? Any central bank's objective is to have a direct correlation between the repo rate changes and the bank interest rate changes. But what was happening here? As you could see that different rates for different customers were there. There were loans given at sub BPLR rates. There was cross subsidization happening. So the main purpose of the RBI was defeated under this interest rate system. And hence, there was a need to switch to another kind of interest rate system, which was supposed to be better than the BPLR system. So in June 2010, another system was there and it replaced the earlier BPLR system. And this new system was the base rate system. Now, by definition, base rate system means the minimum interest rate that a bank could charge to its most creditworthy customers. Remember that in the previous BPLR system, I told you that there was no fixed formula. Under this system, there was an indicative formula. Note the word indicative here. Here, the bank charged interest rate by taking the base rate and over and above that, the spread. So that means the interest rate will be charged as base rate plus the spread. Now, what does spread means? It is a profit margin by a bank which it charges based on the riskiness of the customers. So if a bank finds customer A as a risky customer, then what will it do? It will charge higher spread, higher profit margin so as to compensate itself from any default risk is set by taking four So this base rate is set by taking into account four components. So I will be discussing four components one by one with you guys. So do pay attention here. The first one is the cost of funds. Now, as the name suggests, in the layman language, if we want to understand what cost of funds means, so it means that you know that there is a bank and it gets funds so that it could lend further. So the cost in obtaining those funds is the cost of funds that we are talking about here. So we know that there is a bank. Ignore the drawing over here. Now it could take the deposits and it is taking the borrowings from either the RBI or other banks at repo rate. And the deposits which the bank takes from us, from the general public, it is giving us the deposit rate. So you must be thinking that this system should be perfect in itself. Why? Because there is repo rate over here and the repo rate changes would easily be reflected in the bank interest rate changes, but this was not happening. So this is a very interesting thing to note here and do pay attention. Suppose that the base rate charged by a bank is say of 4% and the spread that it is charging is 1%. So the interest rate that the bank is charging comes out to 5%. Now what I am saying is that this repo rate change is not getting reflected in the interest rate charged by a bank. So as you all know that the deposits mainly comprise of the term deposits which are of long term. Suppose a bank is having a term deposit of say 2 years at 7%. So this means that a bank has to commit itself for paying 7% to a customer for 2 years irrespective of the RBI's repo rate changes. So if it is committing itself to pay 7%, then how could it bear the losses of the repo rate cuts in the interest rate? So therefore, it is not willing to decrease its interest rates as per the RBI's repo rate cuts. because we know that bank is a profit-making institution over here. Now, coming on to the term indicative, which I have mentioned. Indicative means that RBI has not provided any detailed guidelines to the bank. So, a bank could use either the overall cost of funds or the marginal cost of funds or the blended cost of funds or the average cost of funds. So, no specific formula was there, and as a result, every bank was ending in having different base rates for the customers. Now, the second component that we are going to discuss is negative CRR and SLR. Now, as you all know, that CRR means a cash reserve ratio which a bank has to keep with the RBI. And SLR is a statutory liquidity ratio which a bank has to keep with itself, and with that SLR funds, it invests it in some safe assets. So how this is a cost for the bank? This is a very interesting and an inquisitive question. So we shall be focusing on this part for a while. So one interesting thing to note here is that RBI does not pay any interest rates to the bank on the CRR which a bank keeps with the RBI. So no interest is provided, and as a result, this turns out to be a idle cash for the bank on which no returns is available to a bank. So that is why it is a kind of opportunity cost, and therefore it is included while calculating the interest rate under the base rate system. Now, talking about the SLR, as I have told you that a bank invests these funds in the SLR in some safe investments. So sometimes what happens is that the return on these investments turns out to be less than the cost of funds. And that is why this SLR is also constituted and included while calculating the interest rate under the base rate system. Now, the third component that we are going to discuss is the unallocable cost of funds. Here, the cost for a company is taken as a whole and no individual units is taken while calculating the interest rate under this system. So, the examples for this kind of cost will be printing cost, stationery cost. Now, the last component that we are going to discuss is the average return on net worth. So you must have heard about the term hurdle rate, and if not, then don't worry, I'll be telling you what hurdle rate is. So hurdle rate is the expected rate that a bank expects to give it to its equity shareholders, and that is why the term return on net worth is there. So the overall cost of funds will include the actual cost of funds that a bank is incurring while obtaining the funds and the expected cost or the expected rate that a bank expects to give it to its equity shareholders. So as a result, this average return on net worth also becomes a component while calculating the interest rate under the base rate system. Now, what were the shortcomings for this base rate system? Because as a layman, if I see this interest rate system, then I find no problems related to it. But remember that in the cost of funds, I have told you that how the RBI's repo rate changes would not be reflected by the bank in its interest rate changes. So we will be discussing the issues. The first issue, as I've already told you, about the cost of funds, and for this the banks were given the flexibility of choosing any cost of funds, the overall, blended, average or marginal. So any cost of funds could be used by the bank, which created confusion and which led to different interest rates by different banks. The second shortcoming was that no percentage was prescribed by the bank, as it was indicative in nature. No percentage was prescribed. By this, I mean that what proportion of the average return on net worth is to be taken, or what proportion of the cost of funds is to be taken by a bank while calculating the interest rate. So all these were not mentioned by the RBI, and thus it created problems and therefore it was not transparent in nature. So there was again a need to switch to some better form of interest rate system, and then MCLR was introduced in April 2016. Now we will be discussing the most important interest rate system, which is the MCLR. MCLR is the marginal cost based lending rate, and as I have told you in the base rate system that overall cost of funds or any kind of cost of funds were used, but in the marginal cost lending rate, as the name suggests, only the marginal cost of funds was used, which means that only the new cost of funds which is incurred by the bank will be included under the calculation of the MCLR. So with an example, I'll be telling you what new cost of funds means. So for example, earlier a bank used to incur 6% while taking a deposit or while obtaining a fund, but now it incurs only 4%. So this 4% will be included for the calculation of the interest rate under the MCLR system, and this 6% has no role to play in it. Now, as in the base rate system, we have understood four components. Under the MCLR system also, there are four components. So we will be discussing them one by one. So the first one is the cost of funds, or we should say it the marginal cost of funds, as I've already discussed it with you. The second one is negative CRR. I have discussed it with you under the base rate system, and the concept for both of them are same. Note the difference that no SLR is being taken under the MCLR, while negative CRR and SLR was taken under the base rate system. The third one is average return on the net worth. The concept still lies the same for the average return on net worth under the base rate system and under the MCLR. And now the fourth one is tenor premium. So when I will be discussing this fourth point, do pay the attention, because one more concept is related to this tenor premium, which is the interest reset period, and that is quite important to understand. Now, so do you remember that under the base rate system, I have discussed two issues with you. The first issue was related to the cost of funds. Under the MCLR, that issue has been overcome by taking only the marginal cost of funds. And the second issue was that in the base rate system, no percentages were prescribed by the RBI. But under the MCLR, RBI has provided the proportion that is to be considered while calculating the interest rate. So for the cost of funds, 92% has been prescribed, and for the average return on net worth, 8% is prescribed. So as you can see that how MCLR is superior to the base rate system, as it have overcome the issues which the banking system was facing under the base rate system. Now moving on to the fourth and the last component of the MCLR, which is very important. That is the tenor premium. So as the name suggests, the tenor premium, that is a bank charges premium for the tenure of the loan. That means if a loan is for a longer duration, a larger premium would be charged by a bank. And if a loan is for a shorter duration, then a low and a less premium would be charged by a bank. So according to the RBI guidelines, 5 MCLR has to be published by a bank on a monthly basis. So first is for an overnight period. Second is for 1 month period. Third is for 3 months period. Fourth is for 6 months period. And the last one is 1 year period. So here comes the concept that I was talking about. That is the interest reset period. So through an example, we will be discussing what interest reset period is. Suppose you go to a bank to take a home loan at say 1 year MCLR in April 2017. Now, as per this interest reset period mechanism, only in April 2018 will your interest rate be changed. So during this period, if there is any changes by the RBI in its repo rate, then that would not be reflected in your interest rates during this 1 year. It is only after 1 year, as per the 1 year MCLR period rate, that your interest rate would be changed. And same goes for the 3 month MCLR rate or the 6 month MCLR rate. So suppose you go to a bank to take a home loan at 3 month MCLR rate. So only after the expiry of that 3 months will your interest rate be changed. So this is one of the very important topic and the concept under the MCLR system. Now you must be wondering that this MCLR system seems to be totally perfect and there is no shortcoming under this system, then why the RBI's repo rate changes is not reflected in the home loan that my friend, you remember, has taken from the bank. So discussing about the issues in this MCLR system, first, it is the internal benchmark system. First, it is an internal benchmark system. That means that the RBI's repo rate changes will not be truly reflected in the bank's interest rate system, because a bank could either increase its operating cost for compensating a reduction in the repo rate changes. The second one is a credit deposit ratio. Credit deposit ratio means how much a bank could lend out of the funds that it has mobilized. So in India, around 76.3% is a credit deposit ratio, which means that if a bank is getting rupees 100, so taking out the requirements of CRR and SLR, a bank is left with around 76 rupees as the deposits. And this 76 rupees, a bank could further lend to any customer. That means whatever a bank is receiving as deposits, it is able to lend it as funds. As I have told you that bank is a profit-making institution, so why would a bank be willing to reduce its interest rate when at the present interest rate only it is able to lend it to the customers? And the third one is that there is a stickiness in the economy, which means that the deposit growth is slow, whereas the demand for the loans is higher. So amid all these circumstances, there is a need to convert this internal benchmarking system into an external benchmarking system. So now we will be going to discuss our fourth part of the video, which is the external benchmarking. Now RBI has given three rates, either the repo rate or the 91 day T-bill or 182 day T-bill. So a bank could use any of these rates as its external benchmark. Now we will be discussing the advantages as well as the disadvantages of this very system. Starting with the advantages, as a customer, if you go to a bank earlier, you wouldn't be able to differentiate the interest rate or on what basis the interest rates have been charged by the bank. But now after the introduction of this external benchmarking system, it will be very clear in your mind that how a bank is charging its interest rates, because there would be an external benchmark system. Suppose SBI and PNB, for instance, are taking repo rates as its external benchmark. And over and above this external benchmark, the spread, the profit margin is being added by the banks. So the external benchmark system is same. So a customer like you and me now could easily differentiate between the banks that what spreads are being charged by them. So the transparency in the banking system would shoot up. Now talking about the disadvantages of the system. Now with the introduction of this external benchmarking system, the fixed deposit rates that you and me were getting out of the deposits which we used to keep with the banks, now that fixed deposit rate would be converted into the flexible deposit rates. And why would this happen? Because if a bank is committing itself for the external benchmarking system, then obviously, as it is a profit-making institution, so it would want that if the central bank wants it to change its loan rate in tandem with the RBI's repo rate changes, then the deposit rate would also change in tandem with the external benchmark system. So the fixed deposit rates would be converted to the flexible deposit rates. This is one of the challenges that the banking system and the customers will face. And the second challenge will be that the loan rates will become really volatile now. So as you can see that no system is free from the disadvantages or the challenges. Even the external benchmarking system is there with some challenges of its own, because there is no perfect system and every system will be replaced by another system to have more transparency in the economy. I hope that you have understood this concept very well. Now, as promised, I will be asking you two questions and I hope that you guys will be able to answer the questions. So do comment the answers in the comment section below. The first question is that why is there a negative CRR? And the second question is that how the MCLR is superior to the base rate system? And the second question is that what are the challenges that the external benchmarking system is going to face in the economy? So I hope that you guys have understood the four parts of this video very well and now you could able to answer every question. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon. Thank you for watching the video.